Welcome to the CLI ALTMA Innovation and Legal Tech Week On Demand Program. I'm Floor Blindenbach, and I'm the founder of Organizing for Innovation. And we deliver the innovation tools for innovation management to the professional services, including law firms. But today I'm here to talk about what innovation management actually entails, based on a research we did into the innovation management practices of 22 law firms. So I'm looking forward to taking you through. The findings are based on inputs of of 35 respondents and detailed insights of 22 law firms. Most of them had innovation in their job description, and 94% went to law school. The medium loss firm size was 463 lawyers, which means that there was a bias for the larger law firms. That being said, we also had at least three smaller law firms with around 50 lawyers. The volume varied between 1 and 400 innovation projects a year, with the average being at 33 projects per year and a medium at 8 projects. And this research would not have been possible without the very generous funding of the CIT-CRF funding of the state of Virginia. This, what I'm reporting today, is the first part of this study, and I'd love to share with you what the whole study is about at the end of this presentation. To start off, what is innovation management? To some, it may sound like an oxymoron. How can you manage something as creative as innovation? At the same time, we know from years of research that if you don't manage the innovation process, it's very, very difficult to get a return on investment, because it's very easy to spend money on innovation, but creating that return is not. And ensuring that that happens, that's what innovation management is about. Gartner has a much nicer definition. It defines innovation management as a discipline that aims to drive a repeatable, sustainable innovation process or culture within an organization. It's a structured process of generating, validating, prioritizing, developing, and implementing ideas and alternative solutions that would otherwise not have emerged through normal processes. And I hope that you take away from this definition of Gartner is it's a process. And this process has many elements, from generating ideas all the way to implementing them. And it's like a value chain. If you are good at one part of the process, it really doesn't matter, because the weakest link in that process will determine the overall outcomes. So that's also why innovation management is important, because if you want to optimize, you need to identify that weakest link and make sure that you have that throughput. Because in the end, we want to implement innovative ideas and create new solutions and create new services, not just think about them. So what were the results? And I would like to jump right into the results, because I would like to take you to the practical implications of these. So what did we find? We found that all law firms innovate, even the smaller firms, about 1 to 2 projects a year to really like that 400 projects a year. But the frequency really differed. The least innovative law firm initiated about 1 project per 204 lawyers on average, while the most innovative firm had 1 project per 24 lawyers each year. So you see that the frequency of course changes, but that's quite a big, that's a tenfold change. We also saw that there is a preference for low-risk copycat projects, while pioneering projects delivered a better payoff. I'll explain later what this means and how we came to this conclusion. And commonly used selection criteria are not aligned with the characteristics of the most successful projects. So you have one set of criteria, and then we have, if you look at the successful outcomes, they have some different characteristics. And based on the organizational and budget structures, we identified 4 innovation management maturity levels. So between like the 1 project per 204 lawyers and the 1 project per 24 lawyers, we saw like a trend in how innovation is managed. These results I would like to share with you, but let's apply them to something really concrete and practical so that we can see what it would entail. And I would like to use a hackathon for that. For those of you who don't know what a hackathon is, it's like a 1 to 2 day really fun event, high energy, where you invite sometimes just people in your firm, for instance, like your associates, or perhaps for your summer training program, you invite them to work on a specific challenge. And I'd like to use this example of a hackathon to explain the practical implication of our research findings. How are teams selected? And how does a firm at each of the maturity level ensures that the hackathon investments and associated activities deliver the highest possible return? To do that, let's give a little bit more details around this hackathon, because they can be organized in many different ways. And I'm not going to explain what the hackathon is about. I'm just going to explain how you would organize it in these different circumstances. So as I mentioned, the hackathon is a 2-day event. We assume for now the theme of the hackathon is efficiency. So you would have teams brainstorm on how to make the processes in the firm more efficient. And the proposed solutions can be new technologies, processes, new services. Teams consist of 3 people. Teams are recommended to give a demo, but that's not a must. And the outcome is a pitch that explains the solution, the business case, and the project plan. As you mentioned, all in 2 days, these are high energy, very fun events. The question is, how would this, if we look at through this lens at our research findings, what have we learned? Well, let's first start with the selection of winners. And again, I'm here presenting the findings of our research report. So this list of common criteria were the criteria we found amongst the 22 firms. It's the size or the significance of the problem, the pool of lawyers that would benefit, the potential for revenue generation, the resource requirements, the number of key clients the idea would impact, and strategic fit. All very reasonable criteria. There's nothing wrong with it. Except that if we looked at the actual winners, so if we asked our interviewees, tell us about your most successful project, and if we asked them, what are some key attributes or key characteristics of your most successful projects, they mentioned different things. One of the things was that the active involvement of a partner or lawyer with a senior position in the firm was critical. Without such a person on a team, the innovation project was simply not going to be successful. Another finding was that all the stories about the most successful initiative was always where the firm was first, where they embraced the technology first, were the first to start a specific practice group, were the first to do something different. Those were the things that stand out and were their most successful projects. If we know this, why don't we select for them? So this is based just on our experience, but it also makes sense if you compare the current characteristics that are being used and the successful outcomes, because you want to select the projects that have the highest chance of being a success. So better selection criteria would be the active engagement of a partner or other senior level person, the ability to stand out from the competition as a firm, and then the size or significance of the problem, the pool of lawyers that would benefit, the number of key clients in the area the idea would impact, and strategic fit. We can, of course, just keep on adding new criteria, like the top 2 criteria that I just added. But then you get this very long list. So I always recommend if you add something, then also take out some other criteria. So 2 criteria I would recommend leaving out is the potential for revenue generation and the resource requirement. And especially after 2-day hackathon. As you recalled, we had 3 people on a team for 2 days and they have already to create a pitch and to come up with their idea and kind of detail that. For them to make accurate revenue generation and resource requirement predictions in those 2 days, that's kind of unreasonable. They'll put some number down, but it's a speculation, it's an estimate. And to base your selections, like select your projects based on such an estimate, I think there are better ways of doing that. So that's why I would recommend, like, for the very early stage projects, don't really look at those, because these numbers will change. That's one thing I can guarantee. So those were our research findings with regards to idea selection. Let's move on to the maturity levels. So how would a hackathon be organized if we had at these different innovation maturity levels? For that, it may help to understand like how we identified these different maturity levels. We looked through the stories and the questions we asked for the available funding for early stage teams, the level of support available for teams, the structure of the innovation process, and the firm-wide orchestration of innovation efforts. These were kind of the things we were looking for when we started to categorize the firms, the 22 firms. And what we saw were basically four categories: ad hoc, centralized, managed, and optimized. In our sample, we had 8 firms having the ad hoc characteristics, 9 the centralized, and 5 the managed, and 0 the optimized. Now you would wonder, like, how did you then get to that optimized category? Well, we have experience in innovation management. And so there were things we also saw that none of these firms had in our sample, and that you would expect at this very highest level. There was no real correlation between the size of the firm and the maturity level. But there certainly was a relationship between how many innovation projects these firms did. So at the ad hoc level, the average was 1.8 innovation projects per year. Centralized were about 17 innovation projects per year, and managed 123 innovation projects per year. So that's a significant jump, like nearly a tenfold jump between these different maturity levels. And the same for the number of lawyers per project. So that's simply the equation. If you take all the lawyers and divide it by all the projects they're doing, then at the ad hoc level, there were 204 lawyers per project. Centralized, there were about 58 lawyers per project, and managed about 23 lawyers per project. So just to recap, so it's not about firm size, which may be a really good thing for the smaller firms, but it's really about the innovation experience. So let's go to each of these and back to our hackathon example. What does it mean to have an ad hoc innovation management maturity level? And what are the implications for this hackathon that we would like to organize? So at the ad hoc level, we have a volume of between 1 to 10 projects per year. There's not an innovation process, not formalized. The commitment, and this is relative to the other maturity levels, is relatively low. The budget is on a project per project basis, so there's no pre-set budget for innovation. Coordination is ad hoc. And in this setting, innovation certainly happens, even though there's not much structure around it. But because people have to kind of like fight for their own budgets, you see a bit of like favoritism. The more senior people, for them, it's easier to get innovation money for their innovation initiative than it is for the more junior people. And what more, any innovator in this circumstance, they're on their own. So if they're successful, great. But if they're not, it's all on them. So that calls to, like, if you look again to the hackathon, who would organize the hackathon? Who takes it on their shoulders? So it certainly happens. And the story that I've lined out here is not based on something we came up with. This is actually a story that one of our respondents told us. So she took on the initiative to organize a hackathon. There were 5 teams that participated, and they selected one winner. And that winner proceeded in personal times and was looking for funding in the practice groups. And in the end, due to lack of support, the team did not succeed. And did that mean that the hackathon was a failure? Absolutely not. 5 teams learned a lot. It was, yeah, it was great fun. I don't mean this very negative. It was a great experience. I'm saying it puts a lot of burden on the shoulder of that one person that stands up to organize that hackathon and those five teams to stick out their neck and participate. So here are the outcomes, and I'm just kind of like trying to quantify it so that we can compare it for these different maturity levels. So at the ad hoc level, I would expect a frequency of about one hackathon every 3 years. We have about five teams participating in the hackathon and about one team continuing. If you think about like the costs, and these are estimates, again, based on some of our experiences, about $2,500 just to organize it. So that one person that stands up, it takes some time to organize it, put out a call, and make it all happen. Then we have these five teams of three people participating for 2 days. That's man hours too. And I calculated these like eight hours of work at $50. So I've tried to be as reasonable as possible. So that's five times $1,600. And then one times $10,000, because if you have a team that proceeds, they put time and effort in their project. And they go around and they interview people. They need to look for funding. So those hours really easily add up, and we estimated that for any teams that continues at about $10,000. So for $20,000, you have organized this hackathon and energized the firm. Nothing more, nothing less. But if you compare that, for instance, to personal development training about leadership or team building or collaboration, a hackathon is probably a much better way to do so, because this is a real in-life experience. So if you put that in perspective, this is a really good investment. Some best practices at this maturity level. It really helps to have a clear firm-wide strategy. So if there's someone that has an idea, they can kind of like gauge themselves. Are we aligned with where the firm is going? And will I be able to act upon this and get funding? It also helps to create resources for your innovators, reference guides, toolkits, training supports, and coaches, whatever you can do to support them, because they are totally on their own. They don't have a process to follow. And enable collaboration among your innovators so they can support each other, share best practices, and feel less isolated. And clearly, if you have the larger the firm is, if you have multiple locations, this becomes even more important. What we've seen again through the stories, that all the firms, like they move through these maturity levels. So at this level, they started seeing like the frequency went up. They had like 3, 4, 5 people try stuff. They were like, okay, we need to put some structure to this process. So that gets us to the next level, centralized. We see the volume slowly go up to 5 to 25 projects per year. And what has changed is that our centralized intake and of technology or any other project. So someone said like, hey, we need to keep track of who is engaged in these innovation activities. There still is no budget, but there is a coordination. And typically this comes from like the support groups, like IT or knowledge management, because they were the ones that were asked for support, the initiatives that are happening. And they have a need to put some structure behind it. And just again, to tell a story, what happens is teams quickly find out like that's where some funding is, like IT has some budget to execute. So they start shopping. And if they can't get the money from IT, then they go to knowledge management because they also have a bit of budget. So it were these support groups that started to notice like, hey, we need to kind of like orchestrate this process because what we're currently doing is not happening. So that's what centralized is really about. It does mean that for the innovation teams at this level, it's still very difficult to get budget because from an organizational perspective, there's not funding they can tap into. They're on their own. So back to our hackathon. What does that mean? It's clear who organizes the hackathon. IT or the knowledge management department, they are driving this initiative. The hackathon becomes a bit larger too, with 12 teams that participate. 3 winners are selected. And the winners in this time still depend on practice group or support, the support function for their funding. So the hackathon is organized, but there is no guaranteed funding for the follow-up. again, I'm not judging it at all. I've organized a hackathon myself in this kind of setting. It works. Because IT and knowledge management are more on top of it, they provide more structure to their teams, and the practice and innovation teams are on their own. Again, this is not something I'm making up. This is what the respondents shared with me that is happening in their firms. As a result, the hackathon created one successful IT knowledge management initiative, which is awesome. If you compare that to the ad hoc version, at this centralized level, the frequency goes up to about one every year. We have 12 teams in the hackathon. We have 3 continuing teams. With that, it also becomes more expensive to organize. So we kind of multiply these numbers. And we have 3 teams that continue, but now we have 1 team that even that really implements it and goes all the way to the end. Again, that takes time and effort. And we're only looking at man hours here just to make the comparison as simple as possible. And this one team brings a cost-saving solution to the practice, which we value it now at about 20K in cost savings. So we get this first return on investment. It doesn't pay for the full hackathon, but as we said again, like, this is an awesome experience. And now you did not train just 5 teams, but there were 12 teams to participate. So again, from an investment perspective, it's absolutely worth it. But did you get the maximum out of it? Perhaps not. So some best practices at this level. One is move away from annual budget cycles. What a lot of these teams or a lot of firms in this at this maturity level were run into is that budgets were created in an annual cycle. So once in a year, whether it was in March or in June or in January, there was funding available. But that's not how innovation happens. These ideas pop up throughout the year. And so if you happen to have a new idea that comes at the mid in the project cycle, there's no funding available. Worse, there may be funding for projects that started and then turned out to be unfeasible or unrealistic. And so that's where budget is left over. So it just is a really bad mismatch with how innovation works. So try to create multi-year and quarterly investments for your innovation projects so that there's more flexibility to fund projects throughout the year for teams that pivot or teams that start later. And related to that, create an overview. And it can be as simple as an overview that you put like on your SharePoint or your Share Drive so that everyone in the organization is knowing which initiatives are going on. Not all innovation initiatives are successful. That's by definition. it enables you to recognize who's working on what. But especially if you have a larger law firm with multiple locations and in multiple countries, it may be that you have similar initiatives that are happening at multiple locations or in different similar practice groups. So if you keep one centralized list, that's already a huge benefit over the ad hoc level. Just create some kind of structure. From this centralized maturity level, moving on to the next level, the management level, is what these firms see like, hey, we need to organize it better. We need to be able to say no. We can't say yes to all the initiatives. So we need to put some rhyme and reason to the process. And we also need to kind of like provide some basic level of support to all our teams. So that's how we get to the managed innovation management level. The volume really starts to increase. We now are at a volume of about 15 to 200 projects per year. And we have an orchestrated innovation process from start to finish. And the commitment is high. There's a budget for these innovation teams that comes from the innovation committee. So they may not always take the go, no-go decisions, but they certainly pre-select teams and then put them forward to a committee. And there is budget. And the coordination, there is a firm-wide concerted effort to optimize resources and prioritize projects. So they're starting to say no to some of these initiatives. Also because the innovation costs become clear. As you saw in the hackathon example, that's just one initiative. And these are costly. On the one hand, you can say, well, these are man-hour costs, and we are paying for that anyways. At the same time, it's opportunity cost. You could do other stuff. So it's really important to start budgeting all your hours. With the cost becoming clear, you are at the danger of this like negative spiral where you say, wow, there's a lot of money going on in the innovation group. We want to see results. And if you want to see results like right away, you'll start to focus on more incremental innovations. And those were not your successful ones, as we mentioned at the start. So that's one of the key challenges here. How do you make sure that you keep investing and keep investing in like the high risk projects so that you get that higher return on your investment? To our hackathon example, what does that look like? So we have the innovation function now organizing the hackathon. It's their responsibility. Again, it grows in size. 25 teams participate. We have 5 winners selected. These winners get funding, $10,000 to advance their project and find a client or practice group for funding. This, by the way, is also another best practice where you have like match funding. So the innovation group can support, but only to a certain extent, and then they have to find in the practice group additional funding. But at least it gets them through what we call an innovation, the valley of death, this very early stage where they don't know enough to get funding. And so they need some funding to define what the project is about, what the risks are about, and show and demonstrate that it's a worthwhile investment. With the support of the innovation function, 2 teams create a successful new solution, and the result is successful outcomes that pay off for the hackathon. To show again in numbers what this difference means, in this case, the hackathon is just 25 of the 128 projects. So it's just a small thing in the portfolio. There are 5 teams that continue. The costs increase dramatically. So we have here, we are suddenly investing $132,000. That's a decent amount that I think no firm will just kind of like shake out of the, you'll think twice about it. At the same time, you have 1 to 3 teams bring a solution to practice, and you've energized the firm, and this time you also generate about $132,000 in revenues. So the innovation process becomes at least sustainable, and it's revenue generating, but the ROI is now equal, it pays for itself, so to speak. That's a function of many things. One is because these, at the managed level, these firms are able to consistently get teams through from start to finish, and you need finished products to create a financial return. The other thing is also about volume, because not all initiatives will be successful, so you need more initiatives to make sure that you have those few successes that can pay for the whole portfolio. Because as you see here as well, we calculate all the cost of the hackathon, not the cost for just that one project. Because somehow these other projects, they have spent money too, and that needs to earn back as well as part of the innovation process. Best practices at this maturity level, provide incentives for teams to sign up. That's one recurring theme that we heard at this level. Practicing lawyers and practice groups, they're pretty autonomous. So how do you to get them to report to the innovation group that they are starting a new initiative? That's not an automatic given as it is in many product firms. A great incentive is a financial incentive. If you have, like if these early stage teams can get some funding, I can guarantee you that most of them will sign up. It's still not 100% perhaps, but you're getting pretty close to knowing exactly all the innovation initiatives that are ongoing in your firm. And that makes that when you know they started, you can also start tracking and tracing what they have been doing after that. And you can have obtained insights in what they do, learn, and deliver throughout the innovation process. And why is that important? Because you want to know, like, where in this process do your teams break down? Is that because they learn pretty quickly that their idea was not feasible, which is considered a success, Or is that because there are certain organizational challenges in your firm that makes the teams just get really frustrated? For instance, because there is not enough IT support, which means that then you can invest in more additional IT support and move these teams through. So that's why it's so important to kind of like keep track and trace all your projects at this managed level. You have enough to kind of like start to understand where are the strengths and weaknesses in our value chain? Where do we need to spend more money to get more teams through? And previously at the centralized management level, we talked about there needs to be a budgeting process. Here you go one step further and define how you go about funding teams. So it's not about making funds available for a team, but even at the project level, you invest per milestone. You take all costs into consideration. So every single hour, every single resource that's spent on a project is taken into account. And then you use like the affordable loss principle, and it's besides today's presentation to explain what that is. But long story short, you become more sophisticated in how you invest in innovation initiatives, because that's slightly different than you would for, like, say, if you start a new office or do a lateral hire. For that, it's very clear, like, the money that you need up front and then you execute. For innovation projects, it's different, because you cannot be certain that you are on the right path or that it's worthwhile executing. It's this exploratory, experimenting process, and your funding and investments need to be aligned with that iterative process. That brings me to the optimized level. This is something that we have not seen in any of the firms we interviewed. But this is something that you have seen in innovation management literature and also in some other professional service industries, such as engineering and then even in healthcare. So here the volume, it's not so much that the volume goes up, but they look different at the innovation process as a whole. So you have about 100 plus projects a year. So you have a significant volume. You start to optimize the innovation process because they have enough data of these 100 projects to really see, like, where can they optimize it. But there's also a fundamental difference in how they go about budgeting and coordinating, because innovation becomes the vehicle to execute upon your strategy. So the firm may say, like, hey, we want to get stronger in this area or that area. They start to invest and they have now a reliable innovation process where they know for sure if you put in funds, we'll get an outcome that we can rely on. It also means that not all lawyers in the firm will benefit equally. Some practice groups will benefit a lot and get a lot of the funding, and others will get none. Because it's you're going for the highest return. We did not see this level, but that does not mean that we can kind of like, to a certain extent, speculate how that would look like. Just to give you a comparison, how would a firm at that level organize a hackathon? Well, first of all, they would go about it a bit different. They would not just organize a hackathon for the purpose of a hackathon. They would organize a hackathon because they saw like a specific strategic goal that they were not meeting. And then they have a hackathon is a great way to kind of like put some enthusiasm, focus, and fundings in the area that you want to boost. They also know that they will need about 30 teams to get one rockstar winner. So you see, like, they start to organize a hackathon with the end goal in mind. What they also start to do is chop up the innovation process in smaller parts. So they have 10 teams qualifying for a second round, 6 teams proceeding to the development phase. And then with the support of the innovation function, 3 teams create a successful new solution with 1 award-winning team that gets national recognition. The kind of projects I think all law firms would love to have. And based on that super duper outcome, the hackathon suddenly becomes revenue generating and profit generating. So if you look here again at the numbers, in this case, the frequency of the hackathon is just one of the events of the many things that's going on. We have 30 teams in the hackathon. The continuing teams, it's split, like 10 teams move on, they get the opportunity to sort things out, and then six. So if you look at the numbers, so the teams now get $5,000, the 10 teams, and then another gets another $5,000 to continue. We have 1 to 3 teams, again, bringing a solution to practice. And then we have one really successful outcomes. So energize the firm, over 230K in new revenues, and a key strategic area and reputation boost. Awesome outcome of the hackathon, I think. And I hope that this kind of like illustrates the importance of innovation management and what it can do to your innovation process. Best practices at this level. Innovation really becomes an investment. So use a similar process that you use for other firm-wide investments, for instance, like how you go about starting a new office. That way you can support larger initiatives. And just realize that the business case that you need for your innovation project is different because you don't have numbers. Like if you've opened an office and you open a new office, you know the numbers, or same with lateral hire. That's not the case for your innovation project. So just be aware. Review your portfolio on an ongoing basis. The current pandemic is a fantastic example of your budget in 2020 at your start was probably very ill aligned with what you needed for 2020. So that's what we mean with like revise and review your portfolio on an ongoing basis. Are the projects that you put funding towards, are those the ones that you would like to continue? So in this, at this level, there may be a project that's doing everything right, is doing maturing quite nicely, but you still ask them to stop. Because there are other initiatives that need that funding and get priority over an ongoing initiative. Those, by the way, are very difficult discussions to have, and especially in a law firm where you have very independent people driving their projects. So it's not easy. Optimized, and I certainly understand why very few firms get to this level. The other thing is to have successful teams repay so the innovation activities can sustain themselves. As we saw at this level, the innovation the investment became like about above $2,000, $200,000. So it's a significant investment for the whole hackathon. So don't just ask a team to consider the cost for investing in them, but for the whole portfolio of initiatives. Because again, someone needs to pay also for all the failed initiatives. And that's what we, in innovation management, it's that mix of projects. We don't look at one project, but you look at your whole portfolio. That's what you would like to optimize. So if you go back to this overview screen, we have, you can see several things. One is like the increase in volume, in frequency, and as well as in the teams in the hackathon and the continuing teams. There certainly is this increased trend in investments. And there's also an increased trend in like the outcomes that you expect. Well, some firms or may say like, hey, let's get to that optimized level. I just will spend more. I'll put in those about $200,000. And I want to go for that 20% profit. But that's not how it works. Because if you are at the ad hoc level and you would put in $200,000 into a super duper event, I can guarantee your outcomes probably will be, the financial outcomes return will be zero. I'm not saying you will have a super duper event and you'll have energized everyone. But be realistic about the outcomes that you will get. Because if you don't have a structured process, if you don't have the ability to bring ideas to practice, if you just put more funding into it, it is no guarantee that you will get outcomes at the end. For that, you need to have a working process that gets streams from idea generation to development, to implementation, and to scaling. And that's what at these different levels firms have learned, and how to kind of like optimize that process from like how you budget to how you coordinate to how you optimize the process as a whole. And that's kind of what you see throughout this slide. To conclude my talk, it's much easier to spend on innovation than to create a financial return. So be aware. It is possible to create a financial return, but it's not easy. And to do so, innovation management is an absolute must. You cannot just select an idea and hope for the best. You really have to manage that process. And we found 4 different levels of innovation maturity on how to manage that process depending on your experience and the volume and frequency of your innovation efforts. I would really like to thank the CIT-CRCF for the funding. As I mentioned at the start, this was just the first part. This was our, what we call customer discovery of our own research project. Because what we would like what we are working on is see if we can create like a Fitbit type of thing for innovation teams to know like when do they need support, how healthy are they, and how can we best support them. So our hypothesis is if innovation managers have better insights into what teams do learn and deliver, then teams can receive better support and deliver better outcomes. That's the hypothesis we are testing with this research. And we're developing like the predictive analytics that come with that. We would love for you, if you're interested, to participate in this research. Due to the generous funding, we are able to give support to teams for up to 4 months to help them create a project description, a business case, and a project plan. And then participating teams get a benchmark report where they can kind of like evaluate their relative performance. So if you're interested, please reach out to me. My contact details are here at the bottom, fblinden@organizingforinnovation. With that, I come to the end of my talk. I would like to sincerely thank the CLI and ALPMA for organizing this session. If you want to follow them and get more of these kind of awesome content, at least I hope you really enjoyed it, follow them on LinkedIn, Facebook, or Twitter. And you also can find my contact details if you have questions about this presentation. If you would like to download the report, you have the link here on the slide. And if you want to participate in our research, we would love to see you as one of our teams. Thank you.